conduct a service to be broadcast over the internet. And then we finally came back, but we came back to roped-off pews. Gradually, we have returned to normal, except the one thing that we do not do yet, or may never do, is collecting the offering, passing the plate. Now we do it kind of like it was done in Jesus' time. There's a place to deposit your offerings as you enter the church. Though we sometimes refer to them as our tithes, or sometimes our sacrificial giving, we never confuse those offerings with the Old Testament practice of coming all the way up to the altar with a live offering that would cover our sins. That's one of the elements that did not carry over from the Jewish practice to the Christian form of worship. And why is that? It's because God made the all-sufficient sin offering on our behalf when Jesus went to the cross. The spotless Lamb of God was given not to just cover, but to atone for all of our sins. So we need no animal sacrifices, no grain sacrifices, no drink offerings in order to gain or to remain in God's favor. You will not find an animal pen in our parking lot. There are no butchering tables outside the chancel. You will not find a wood fire burning underneath our altar. There is no metal grill sitting on top of it. I guess you could say Christian worship is a lot more sanitized than your typical day in the Temple of Jerusalem. Well, all of that is because Jesus has completed the bloody, grimy work of sacrifice that the priests were once called on to do. Once, God's covenant of grace was bounded by a framework of laws, things that were done here on earth. And it required intermediaries, and that was the priestly clan from the tribe of the Levites. And their work began with cleansing prayers and offerings for themselves, because they were sinners just like everybody else. But Jesus is the high priest who needs no pre-cleansing. He isn't made righteous. He is divinely righteous. It's just what he is by his nature. He isn't the petitioner for your forgiveness. He is the grantor of your forgiveness. That's what made the priests and the scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the teachers of the law, everybody in the Jewish establishment at that time, so shocked at what Jesus offered. In a single pronouncement, Jesus would grant what these workers of the law dedicated their whole careers to accomplish, and that is peace with God and innocence before him. So who needs a priestly clan when Jesus has declared us forgiven by his grace? In this church that is now the body of Christ, as a matter of fact, we are all priests in service to our Lord. And by his grace, we're clean. By grace, we offer acceptable prayers ourselves and for all people. And by grace, we bring offerings of praise and service, money and resources for the work of the church. And by grace, we have a real encounter with the presence of our Lord and his body and blood given and shed for us at the cross and distributed to us from this ceremonial altar in his house. This is just the latest of many reasons that the author of this letter to the Hebrews gives in order to demonstrate that Jesus all by himself is better than every and all facet of Judaism that the Hebrews had come from. Exactly what was happening among this congregation, we don't know. We don't know where they came from, but somewhere outside of Jerusalem is the best guess. But we do know this congregation of the Hebrews was a discouraged group. Perhaps they were only a remnant of their former congregation. And they were discouraged to the point of asking, why should we bother to make the come together to worship on the Lord's Day. Well, it probably was not a virus that was keeping them home on their couches in fear. It was probably opposition from their neighbors, criticism from their families, harassment by their government. Because in the Roman Empire, Christians were seen as nonconformists. They followed neither their own civic religion of Judaism, nor were they worshipers of the emperor and his cult. And so they were deemed untrustworthy. Rumors were circulating about what they did behind those closed doors. There was talk of the eating of flesh and the drinking of blood. And this constant chatter about them was taking its toll. Throw in an instance or two of violent persecution, and you have a community that now begins to question its meaning and its purpose. And it seems as if some people had already left. Others had become increasingly absent from their places in the congregation, and that's why this letter, the letter to the Hebrews, was sent to them. And so the letter says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And that's always what it comes down to, whether it's the first century AD or here in the 21st. Do not look to the culture around us for moral support. They're not going to bring you righteousness. They're going to sell you some products. They're going to tell you what's popular. They're going to show you a lifestyle they think that you should imitate, but they're never going to bring you righteousness. They're not going to bring you to Jesus to hear him pronounce your forgiveness and to make you right with God. They're not going to commission you to do priestly acts of service in God's kingdom of righteousness. But in Christ, we have a hope that never wavers. Our Lord sits now at the right hand of God as the only intermediary we'll ever need. And we are a royal priesthood because we're connected to Jesus directly through his commission. It was to us that he said, go and baptize and teach and make disciples of all nations. And he who promises this is truly faithful. We have his full authority to speak his promises, to intercede for the needs of this world, as well as for our families and for our neighbors. And so, the writer continues, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. The passion that that congregation of the Hebrew Christians once had apparently grown cold. They had forgotten who they were, because they had forgotten whose they were. Those who left, or those who were left, now had a project on their hands. How could they reconnect with those who had left the fellowship of the disciples? Maybe they had tried ways to reactivate the missing among them. Maybe they had tried appealing to their sense of duty. Maybe they had highlighted the consequences of the law against those who failed to pay God their proper worship. But the power that works within Christians is the power of the gospel. That is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Gentile. Only the gospel can ignite the passion that would make a sinner by nature into a disciple by grace. The Christian faith is, at its heart, a relationship. It's a relationship between a sinful human being and a perfectly righteous God that is built on that loving sacrifice of Jesus. The perfect intermediary, who is truly God and truly human, who offered himself in sacrifice for full pardon of all of our sins. That really is the only building block for real church growth and for real discipleship in his name. But the full-time goal of God's sworn enemy, who is Satan, to be implored to not neglect to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encourage one another, all the more as you see the day drawing near. COVID is something that prompted many in the church to ask some very challenging questions, like, what is the purpose of a church and physically gathering in one place? Well, I think we know that as much as the building is a blessing to us, it's not the building that we come here for. When St. Peter made his bold confession of Christ, saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God," Jesus replied to Peter, "On this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." And the word that Jesus used for church in the Greek language is ekklesia. And ekklesia doesn't mean a building. It means a people who have been called out from their everyday lives that they might serve in some special way. So perhaps you can be special when you're drinking your morning coffee in your easy chair, with the service streaming on your laptop, or the televangelist appealing to you on your television. Sometimes, I guess, the church electronic may be your only means of fellowship in the Word. But Jesus calls us to be made special in His grace. And nowhere is that grace going to be more freely bestowed than it is in the words spoken aloud in the midst of the gathering of his disciples, serving as the healing balm for the sin that isolates us. It is the application of his grace that is proclaimed from the pulpit. It is visibly applied in baptismal waters that anoint us. And it is present in our Lord's body and blood, his supper that nourishes us at his altar. And so the Holy Spirit encourages us that we would draw near, come close, with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. That's the language of a relationship. A relationship between Christ and his people, in which our high priest unites us in his forgiveness, just as the priests of the temple used to do every single day, morning and evening. The book of Acts shows us the church in its very beginnings. And from its beginning, it has been the people of God gathering for the purpose of preaching and praying, for sacrament and for service. And the imagery of the divine service in the book of Revelation is one of God's people being gathered around the throne of the Lamb, joining angels and archangels and all the company of heaven to sing God's praises and receive Christ's benefits. So we simply cannot neglect this gathering, because it is within this body of Christ, the gathering of his saints on earth, that our Lord graciously distributes his gifts, the very gifts that keep us in the faith. Gathering in the Word and at the font and before the altar of God with our brothers and sisters is the very work of God to sustain us into life everlasting. That is why we go to church, because Jesus has invited us. Congregation, please stand as we sing hymn 787, "The Temple Rang with Golden Coins."
Thank you.
sanctifies us for godly service, that with every good work we may do his will and be pleasing in his sight. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the church throughout the world, that we may be ready at all times for Christ's glorious return, and that our Lord would give us zeal to proclaim his coming to the ends of the earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all in authority, especially the President and Congress of the United States, the Governor and the Legislature of our state, and all judges, that God would graciously enable them to lead according to his will and for our good. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all pastors and ministers, that they may preach the pure doctrine of God's saving word, which will never pass away, and that those who hear with faith may have the peace that passes all understanding. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In thanksgiving for the fruits of the earth provided by God's hand, that he would supply the needs of all who grow, process, distribute, and serve our food, and that we may be moved to share his bountiful gifts with our neighbors in their time of need, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and the infirm, the dying of all those in need, especially Lynn Ambrose, Phil Taylor, Sharon Taylor, Jim Berquist, Pam Booth, Kevin Bruning, Joanne Clark, Connie Davis, Nancy Forbes, Denise Jambroni, Dorothy Haas, Gary Hill, Ron Madison, Mike Mager, Emma, Christine Bicker, Darwin Poehler, Dick Redons, Aliana Randall, Norma Raybould, Tom Roll, Nancy Smith, and Joanne Wagner. That in their distress, God would grant healing and faith to endure their afflictions with patience. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Grant these and all our petitions, O God, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Hear us as we pray in Jesus' name and as he has taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory,
forever and ever. Sanctify the whole Christian church by your Holy Spirit. Hear our prayers for all her members, and mercifully grant that by your grace we may serve you in true faith through Jesus Christ our